you that do or do not know me, I'm Pastor Howard Harris. I pastor Southeast Church in Talmadge, Ohio. I also run Students with a Goal in Summit Lake, which is the largest free after-school program that goes Monday through Thursday. We average about 50 kids a day. We do tutoring, we do homework, we do a lot of different things with them every day. I'm just happy to be here again. This is such a warm and loving congregation. It's just a pleasure to bring God's word. Would you just mind? I'm just going to open us with a brief prayer, and then I'm going to dive in. This is going to be, there's a lot to the sermon today, so there's going to be some meat. Father, while the meditation is open, allow ears, not just the ears, but the ears, to bring us to the Lord. Today's sermon is Cultivating. We're going to be looking from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. I'm here this Sunday and next Sunday, so it's a two-week series, but it's based on a book. I would suggest reading it if you get some time. It's available on Kindle. It's available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, wherever, but it's called Failing Faith. When what you thought you knew about God doesn't work in the real world. In America, a prevailing notion exists that spiritual well-being is intertwined with physical happiness. But what happens when life happens? What happens when the bills are piling up, the threat of foreclosure looms, a loved one is in critical condition, or the weight of depression and sorrow make the sunless days dark? These circumstances can profoundly shake Christians, leaving them to question their faith or even God. Today we embark on this two-week series inspired by Failing Faith. On page 9 and 10 of Failing Faith, Wade Bearden recounts a conversation he had with a friend about his faith. You see, like most of us, or some of us, his Christianity was built around comfort, control, and certainty. All that fell when life became hard. When a loved one was diagnosed with uncurable cancer, he started to examine how his faith was not rooted in the gospel, but really rooted in prosperity. As we begin today, we will dig into a story about a young man you might be able to relate to. Open your Bibles to Mark 10, and we're going to look at 17 through 20. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. He said, "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You should not give false testimony. You should not defraud. Honor your father and mother." "Teacher," he declared, "all these I have kept since a boy." Point number one is God is not simply a tool. Jesus challenged this man's belief system. And since you could interpret Jesus' words in verse 18 like this, "There's only one who is good, and that's God. Do you really believe I'm God, or are you just saying that to flatter me and to giving you the response you desire. I think this man believed that God or faith, in addition to good deeds, would just be one piece of the puzzle to salvation. Notice how he didn't call Jesus good a second time in verse 20. This man anchored his faith and salvation in the ideology of a divine checklist of good actions. Sadly, in doing so, God became reduced to a mere tool. Now, I'm going to give you what I learned from Urban Dictionary, if that's okay. Urban Dictionary, which is sort of a sarcastic look at slang words, said, a tool is someone who lacks the mental capacity to know he is being used. So is God Tim the Tool Man Taylor? Do we worship God like a studio audience at tool time? Some of y'all will relate, is God a mouse? God is not on our means to achieve personal comfort, power, wealth, and health. But somehow this man perceived God as a tool rather than perceiving God as divine. This man's faith revolved around his own success, comfort, and acts of righteousness. Yet, it ultimately crumbled when confronted with the truth embodied in Jesus. How often are we like this man? Our attitudes and actions merely mask our faltering faith. We attend church services and do things in our community convinced that by checking off a mere box, we're going to get eternal life. Sky Daddy will gift us a Tesla, abs of steel, a spouse who moonlights as an Instagram model. Or perhaps our faith lies in the idolized vision of God, who loves us unconditionally even when we abuse his grace. This is not the gospel of Jesus, but a shallow pool of comfort and selfishness. The God revealed in Scripture is infinitely bigger than our limited imaginations can conjure. Transcending mere virtual signaling, true faith is about wholeheartedly putting our trust in the Lord himself, unconditionally, unwaveringly, regardless of the path it may lead us on or the challenges we may encounter along the way. True faith is profound commitment to embracing the unknown with steadfast trust in the divine guidance of the Holy Spirit. Contrary to the perspective often emphasized in alternate viewpoints, in our educational systems, they'll tell you, you are how you succeed. They'll tell you to read self-help literature, and they'll discuss how you have the power in yourself to better yourself. In the last few weeks, I cannot watch a football game without hearing the name Taylor Swift. It's like she's a player on the field. And this past summer, I had the chance to take 10 students on a college tour, and we went to Nashville, Tennessee, and we saw 4 Christian colleges and 2 state colleges. As part of our itinerary, we explored the planetarium one evening. At the planetarium, we got a chance to view a light show. And this light show was just incredible. And the music they played in the background for 30 minutes. What struck me during the light show was the profound impact of her lyrics. Every song was about heartbreak and failed relationships. It prompted me to dig deeper because I said she has to have more than just heartbreak and failed relationships. And I ended up watching a few of her captivating music videos. One that stood out to me was Out of the Woods. Taylor Swift stands on a picturesque beach, gradually finds and snare her as she navigates a somber forest, singing about heartache and anger. anguish. She is haunted by both the forest and a pack of wolves. The wolves tear her dress, relentlessly pursuing her to the summit of the snow-covered mountain amidst a fierce blizzard. The situation worsens as Swift later struggles through a swamp, a desert, and a raging firestorm. Sort of like a hot. Finally, when she reunites with the beach, she approaches her former self, gently touching her shoulder. The video concludes with the words, "She lost her, but she found herself." Somehow, that was the point. This video does provide an interesting window to 21st-century pop culture philosophy. Finding true peace means finding yourself. You alone hold the answers to the meaning and the purpose. That's not the gospel. Be careful what you're letting in and you're pursuing. If we're not careful, our faith can become less about serving our Creator and more about using our faith to justify our success or feel secure. The Apostle Paul in Romans 1:20-21 illustrates this risk. Though they knew God, although they knew who, they neither glorified him as God or Christ. Instead, exchanged their glory of the immortal God for images made to look like a mortal. Y'all with me this morning? Y'all with me this morning? I'm teaching more than I'm preaching this morning. I want you to understand. When we look at ourselves for the answers, we're exchanging the glory of the immortal God for images that look like a mortal human. I don't have to tell you there's only two things comes in the world, right? I've got to tell you. So don't think you're gonna live forever. I know some of y'all seen Talladega Nights. People say, you just transferred a pig's heart into a man's heart. That's it. That's hope. It's not that. When we become lovers of ourselves, we have reduced it. There is a correlation between faith found in God and even when we have a clear understanding of God's nature, it does not exempt us from the temptation of replacing his glory with our own. I'll say that again. Even when we know who God is, don't think that because you follow all the commandments, if you don't have a personal working relationship with God, you run the risk of exchanging the glory of God. Without fully surrendering to his will and path, we risk falling into self-centered, pleasure-seeking mindsets, which may lead us to overlook the beauty and purpose that emanates. As Christians, instead of seeing ourselves as the pinnacle of existence, let's refocus our hearts and our minds on God. Let's wholeheartedly embrace his divine guidance. Remember, Jesus is the answer. Let's move on to Mark 10:21-22. Jesus looked at him, and what? He looked at him. One thing you lack, he said, go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great I don't know about you. I don't know where you're at in your life, but I'm going to tell you, we all yearn for a Savior. We're all yearn for a Savior because we're all broken. The words that deeply resonate with me in this passage is Jesus looked at him and he loved him. This is not that Christian on the high pedestal pointing down at the sinner. He comes from a place of love, our Savior. Despite one's shortcomings and faults, he looked beyond them. He saw this man. He saw that this man honestly and earnestly wanted to have eternal life. Notice that invitation and the challenge. He answers the man's question and gives him an opportunity to build his faith. Faith, as defined in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, says, is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The biblical concept of faith presents both a challenge and an opportunity for trust. It's a challenge because it requires us to believe in and hope for the unseen, often in spite of our flaws and our brokenness. Faith in the biblical sense may mean being like the patriarch Abraham. Can you go to Hebrews 11, 8 for me? And this is what the patriarch Abraham did. He obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. We're like Moses. In verse 25 and 26 of the same chapter in Hebrews, that said he chose to be mistreated. See that free will there? Moses could have walked away. But it was by one. He chose to be mistreated. Not only that, he chose to regard disgrace for the sake of Christ as a greater value than treasures of Egypt, because he was looking ahead to his reward. Biblical faith is not instant gratification, but could involve sojourning, mistreatment, and displeasure. However, biblical faith fosters unwavering trust in God, as demonstrated by Abraham and Moses. As his faith matured, Moses gained a deeper understanding of God's power and his will. When we dig deeper into the spiritual practices of prayer, reading our Bibles, fellowshipping, giving of alms, clothing the homeless, going and visiting those who are sick and are in prison, and we do that by faith, God will reveal himself. And you say, how do you know this, Pastor? How do you know this? If you go to verse 27, this is one of the verses we overlook in this scripture so often. I want you to look at what it says. He persevered because he saw him who is. He persevered and he saw him who is invisible. If you persevere, you will see him who is invisible. With this sacred test lies a profound revelation through life's trials and tribulations as we navigate our Egypt-like challenges, confront those pharaohs in our lives, and endure plagues. Our unwavering perseverance unveils the growth of faith. The faith enables us to grasp the invisible and foster resilience. Faith guiding perseverance culminates into a transformative journey. It fosters an intimate relationship with God, where the intangible substance of hope and the unseen evidence converge into visible realities. Have you ever wondered why Grandmama, she knew. Have you ever wondered why that old preacher from back in the day, he knew. He could see it. For their faith that used to be the size of a mustard seed had become the size of a pumpkin seed. They had persevered faith that matured and did not lack anything. In Hebrews 11:27, God promises a seed. Moses gave up everything because of faith, and because he gave up everything because of faith, he got to experience God. And Jesus' response to the man, he not only encourages the man to reconsider his understanding of God, but also his perception. Notice that how the man initiated his question by asking, "What must I do?" This demonstrates his overestimating the virtues that he had, and he underestimated his profound need. Are you overestimating your goodness and underestimating your need for God? Jesus responds to sinners around the idea of atonement. You want a relationship with God, you're going to have to free yourself of all those things that are clinging on to you. And even back then, this was sort of a weird response. This was sort of, why would Jesus tell this man he had to give up everything? In ancient Israel, many thought that being wealthy and successful showed true faith in God. Even the disciples believed that if you really are blessed by God, you will be wealthy. Where do we see this? In John chapter 9, verse 2, where it says, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" In the Gospel of Mark that we're reading today, we come across a fluid individual whose prosperity contributed to his obedience. His wealth seemingly ensured a comfortable life in the world and the promise of a blessed afterlife. However, his material possessions did not signify his righteousness. Rather, they revealed the vast gap between him and his spiritual aspirations. Today, we have preachers like Joel Osteen. Feel good message. This is actually a concept. This prosperity gospel, as they call it, was created by E.W. King at the turn of the century. And he mixed New Age theology with biblical theology. And he affirmed phrases like, "God is in me, God's build is mine, God strengthened me, God health is mine, his success is mine." And what has happened in our society is when God doesn't come through, it has seeped to even evangelical circles. In a thought-provoking article titled "Death of the Prosperity Gospel," Kate Bowler shares a personal journey of grappling with King's theological legacy and attempting to understand the concept of a blessed life. Within the article, she dives into the challenge of suffering within the context of the prosperity gospel. Adherents are discouraged from discussing death, as they are required to speak healing into their lives. Failure to do so implies that healing will not manifest. In essence, according to the prosperity gospel, one's experience aligns with their thoughts. I would say you need to be careful. How frequently do we find ourselves thinking, "If I only work hard enough or maintain a positive mindset, everything will be fine"? God is not Sky Daddy. He's not a genie in the bottle. You need to rub him the right way. Only when we shift our focus from comparing ourselves to others to comparing ourselves to Christ can we truly embrace the grace of God. In closing, I'm only going to read verses 21. Actually, I'm going to read it all. We're going to read the rest from Mark. I'm going to start at 21. Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor. You will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had done well. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard is for the rich to enter the kingdom?" The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard is it to enter the kingdom? It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were even more amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." Then Peter spoke up, "We have left everything to follow you." I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one who has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or failed for me in the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age. Homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last first." I'm going to close with this right here. Receiving grace depends on our response to Jesus. After Jesus delivered a difficult truth to the man, it was out of love that he did so. He instructed the man to sell his possessions and become his follower. Let's take note of what he commanded in verse 21 implies. This man must let go of the things he considered as proof of his righteousness and give them to the people he perceived undeserving. He must wholeheartedly pledge his loyalty to Jesus. Unfortunately, the man left disheartened. His lack of trust became evident. He desired a financial safety net instead of relying on God. His love for money, power, comfort, and stability overshadowed his love for God. Accepting grace means acknowledging our sole dependence on Jesus. We must commit ourselves entirely and unwaveringly to following Christ. One of my favorite books of all times, is The Prodigal God by Timothy Keller. In his book, Timothy relays a conversation he had with a young woman. The woman had grown up in a church that taught God only accepted those who lived good, ethical lives. Upon hearing Keller's teach about this, that God's gift of salvation is completely free, even to those who are immoral, the woman expressed fear. Keller asked her about it. Her reply was telling, "If I was saved by good works, then there would be a limit to what God could ask of me or put me through. I would be like a taxpayer with rights. I would have done my duty, and now I would deserve a certain quality of life. But if it is really true that I am a sinner saved by sheer grace at God's infinite cost, then there's nothing he cannot ask of me." Keller goes on to explain that this is precisely why many people are scared of grace. It removes our control over the situation and put God in charge. We often feel more comfortable when we think we can do something, anything, to make ourselves worthy of salvation, even if it's just a little bit. But grace. something that we didn't earn. It was given freely. And we must accept his gift of grace with humility, understanding that salvation is a gift, not something we can ever earn or we actually deserve. What hinders us from fully accepting God's abundant gift of grace? Could it be the allure of wealth and material possessions, the thirst for power and control, or the security found in living a comfortable life? In our text today, Jesus gently and lovingly, he lets us know that we need his grace. I don't know where you're at right now with your walk with Christ. But he has an open invitation for you. Come follow me. Now you may feel that there's a lot of baggage I got here, God. It used to be a game show. I loved it. It was called Baggage. It was a dating game show. They had three contestants that started. One person that was looking at these three contestants, possible people they would be. And every round, the contestants would mention one piece of baggage in their life, something that is a red flag to a lot of people, and they would just get that off. And the person who was selecting a date would say, yes, I would like to move forward, or no, that's too much baggage for me. What I'm telling you right now is, God is saying that's not too much baggage for me. And he's saying his arms are open wide and you can lay your baggage right here at the altar. Don't worry about tomorrow. Because if his eye is on the sparrow, it surely will be. Embrace the gift of God's grace and salvation through Jesus Christ. Place your faith in him rather than worldly pursuits. Know that God loves you. Remain faithful, and his promises will never fail. May you be blessed abundantly as you live in his love. I pray for each and every one of us that we all have so much faith that we will see the blessing. We pray with me. Father God, if there's someone here today that has unbelief, we come here today in prayer that you will help their unbelief. That if we're struggling right now with baggage and things that we're carrying around, and we're unsure, and we think that the stakes are too high to follow you, that we will have trust and faith, even faith the size of a mustard seed, to give each and everything, obstacle or barrier in our lives to you right now. I pray right now that everyone underneath the sound of my voice, that they will experience the love, the warmth, the acceptance found in you. Know that this trials and tribulations that we may be going through at this moment will only last for a little bit of time. But joy will come. I pray this in your holy and righteous name, Jesus. In church, say amen.